News-BBC1, a new light-hearted way to start your day. Breakfast time. Each morning from Monday to Friday, 6:30 to 9, with Frank Moff, Selena Scott, Nick Ross and Debbie Ricks. Breakfast time, starting next Monday on BBC1.
On BBC2 in a minute, there begins a new series examining the moral judgments which doctors have to make in deciding, for example, whether to tell a patient that he has cancer. The first of six real-life doctor's dilemmas on BBC2. Here on One, in 25 minutes, you can see the first of the highly acclaimed plays, Boys from the Black Stuff, about a tarmac gang looking for work in Merseyside. But first, the 9 o'clock news with John Humphreys.
Rates rise. Mrs. Thatcher's message to Argentina. We'll defend the Falklands for a long time to come, she says. The humour that comes with the protest at a nuclear inquiry. Mr. Tebbit's plans for union reform. More union bashing, says the TUC. And the last of the giant killers, Bishop Stortford against Middlesbrough in the FA Cup replay. Good evening. The government's hopes for cheap money and low inflation have taken a knock. The cost of borrowing has gone up again for the second time in 2 months. Three of the big high street banks have put their interest rates up by a full 1% to 11%. And it's possible they'll go even higher. The reason, a sharp drop in the value of the pound. At one point today, it reached its lowest point ever against the German mark. Against the dollar, it had fallen by 2.5 cents. But then interest rates rose and the pound went up. Here's our economics correspondent, James Long.
The pressure was on the pound from the word go this morning, with selling orders piling in. Foreign exchange dealers found themselves taking calls from people they don't often deal with, businessmen in out-of-the-way parts of Europe, rather than just the mainstream speculators. It seems they took Mrs. Thatcher's trip to the Falklands as a sign of an early general election, and started worrying about a big devaluation of the pound if Labour came to power. Others, stuck with the more familiar scare, have a fall in oil prices. Then came the rise in interest rates. The result was quite a recovery, with the pound closing only 0.5 cent down on the dollar at $1.58.4, having been within a fraction of its all-time low. Against the German mark, it broke through the old low but recovered to finish with a gain on the day at 3.71 marks. The rise in interest rates is a major setback for industry, but there's one piece of good news. The building societies, who meet on Friday, say they're very unlikely to raise the mortgage rate. They'll wait another month to see what happens. Last time interest rates went up, 6 weeks ago, the government had a fairly direct hand in the move. This time, the Bank of England simply stepped out of the way, letting events take their course. The Shadow Chancellor, Mr. Peter Shaw, tonight said the opposition would demand an urgent government statement on the rise in interest rates. The Treasury view is that the pound's fall is partly due to Mr. Shaw's plan for a big devaluation if Labour came to power. Mr. Shaw said it was nonsense to blame him. Tonight, senior Conservative sources were apparently trying to pour cold water on the fears of an early election that had started the selling from overseas. The government will be watching how the markets now react with some concern. If high interest rates continue to be necessary, it can only make the problems of recession still worse. If the pound falls further, it could undermine the fall in inflation. What happens now depends partly on what happens to interest rates in America. In New York, share prices have been reaching new record highs daily until tonight, on hopes that rates will come down. Martin Bell reports on Wall Street's latest dealings and on a new turn in the trade war.
These are frantic times on Wall Street. Trading was again heavy today and prices slightly down after yesterday's surge, which put the Dow Jones at a record level. Falling interest rates were given as one reason, cautious forecasts of an end to the recession as another. Only the energy sector remains sluggish. And it's one of the reasons given here for the pound's poor performance that Britain, of course, is an oil producer and its revenues are expected to suffer from any fall in the price of oil. Fluctuating exchange rates are also given as the reason for the other main economic news out of here today, a new American farm program that may be construed as the first shot in a coming trade war. President Reagan left the White House today for Dallas to offer new hope to the country's farmers suffering from rising surpluses and falling prices. The cheese and butter mountains held underground in huge reserves in Missouri are just part of the agricultural surpluses that the Americans say they can't get rid of because of the strength of the dollar and unfair competition, especially from Europe. Now they'll answer with export credits of their own, $250 million worth announced by the president today. And further protectionist measures are also threatened. And farmers are to get something called payment in kind. Wheat farmers will be paid in wheat for the wheat they don't produce, and cotton farmers in cotton. It sounds topsy-turvy, but that's what the administration plans to do, and with it takes 23 million acres out of production. Some officials say they're already in a trade war, others say not yet. But the Americans serve notice today they're going to protect their farmers.
Britain will go on defending the Falklands for a long time to come, the Prime Minister has said. Mrs. Thatcher spent the day visiting Royal Navy units on the islands and looking at rebuilding work in Port Stanley. There, last night, she received the freedom of the islands in the town hall. Hundreds of islanders attended the presentation. In recognition, the Executive Council said, of her courageous, steadfast, and unyielding leadership. Before the ceremony, she toured some of the Falklands battlefields. Nicholas Witchell was with her.
Day three of the Prime Minister's visit. For her tour of inland settlements, a detachment of troops were carried in an escort helicopter, some with portable anti-aircraft missile launchers tucked in between their knees. The Prime Minister's helicopter followed some distance behind, passing low over the hills and mountains around Stanley. At Fitzroy, the escorting soldiers fanned out to positions around the settlement. An artillery battery showed how it could fire off its guns, and then the Prime Minister was invited to have a go. Some confusion here about which dials to turn.
2258.
Then the earmuffs went on, and it was time to try to fire the thing. With flowers and mementos. It was in the confined space of this hall that all 114 people of the settlement were held captive for a month.
Can I say thank you very much for these lovely things, for this badge which has helped us
somber as the Prime Minister headed on for her major task, across the islands to the spot where the main battle for the islands began. The bodies of 14 servicemen have, at their families' wishes, remained in the San Carlos Cemetery rather than be brought home. With Admiral Sir John Fieldhouse, who directed the task force operations from London, at her side, the Prime Minister walked slowly into the small plot to lay her wreath at the foot of a plain wooden cross. That done, she went first to the grave of Lieutenant Colonel H. Jones, V.C. Then she went on to inspect the other graves, one by one, lingering by each. It was a somber moment, one clearly of great.